Hello, coming thick and fast now. So video number five. I'm going to pick up where we left off. Just a bit of housekeeping. As I mentioned at the end of video four, code is up on GitHub now. You'll see I've got a repository, ESP32 YouTube series. At the moment, there is the main and the YouTube branches. It's the YouTube branch you want. In due course, I will sort all of the branches and all version control and everything out. So yeah, it's a bit more logical using Gitflow, and we can possibly talk through that if you're interested in doing version control properly. More than happy to cover it. Put your thoughts down below in the comments so I know, and happy to do so. And in the video description of each video moving forwards will be a link to the commit from the end of that episode. So that commit will take you to the exact code that will be on my screen at the end of that video, so you've got all the info there. So that links to the commit, and of course that will progress as this project progresses. So where we left off before, we were talking about mutual exclusion basically, and ensuring that things that we only want to happen once only happen once, irrespective of whether they're called multiply across different tasks or threads, or across different CPUs. Bear in mind the ESP32, bar the new S2 stuff, is dual core, ignoring the ultra low power stuff, but that is, you can't compile C++ for that anyway, or C, it's assembly only. At least for the time being, that'd be really cool to be able to get a compiler for that. But anyway, that's not the thing at the moment. So we looked at the different ways we can do this, using Atomic or using the standard library, mutexes. I sort of glanced over this thing here and how it works. Basically, a standard mutex, we could just use it on its own and acquire the lock, which is a function call. If you just Google standard mutex, it'll take you to the C++ reference or your sort of wiki, I suppose, for want of a better word, of choice. And there's a call to take it and a call to give it back. It's acquire or lock on something else there. They use different naming conventions to free RTOS. This basically does it in a RAII way. So if you're not familiar with RAII, resource acquisition is initialization. It's a concept basically. No, shouldn't use that word, because C++ concepts are now a thing. In C++ 20 and beyond, I believe. I don't think they're in 17, which is what this is. But basically, it means that when you acquire a thing, an object in this case, you also initialize it. Because you've acquired it, so it by default initializes itself as well, and that's the way we want to do things. And what that also means is when it goes out of scope and you relinquish it, it also deinitializes it, and that's how we can get away with not giving the mutex back when we go out of scope. We block in this method, so we don't ever need to take it. Basically, it's wrapped up within this object, and there's pros and cons to that, but it looks neater in the code, easier to follow. One thing to note, however, is this mutex is not recursive, so we cannot take it multiple times, even if it is the same thread trying to take this. There are recursive mutexes, but for this at the moment we don't need it. So that is a thought later down the line, if you might need a recursive mutex. So perhaps this exact same mutex is acquired by a child class, and then that child class acquires this mutex, goes into the base class, i.e. Wi-Fi constructor, tries to acquire it again, and it cannot because it has already been acquired. So it will stick here and it will block. You can use a recursive mutex, which basically means, is the person trying to acquire this the person who currently owns it? And in that example, it would say you're trying to acquire a mutex, but you already have the mutex, so I'm going to let you through. This doesn't do that, but other types of mutexes do, and we can cover that if we need it. But the focus of this video, I wanted to show you another way of doing this using free RTOS mutexes, and that's exactly what we're going to do. So what we need to do is, first of all, include the free RTOS semaphore header, which I can never remember. So I'm just going to, in fact, I'm just going to copy that entire chunk. We'll get rid of the standard template library, and it's semfer. Have I spelt that right? I think I have. Semfer. Yeah, I think that's right. Anyway, we'll find out shortly. And there's two different ways of doing this now. So we'll do it the easy way first. I might even show you the recursive way later as well. So here we go. So what we're going to have, we still have our mutex, but it's got a different definition now. Oops. Copied in too much. So the semaphore handle type, bit confusing because this is called a semaphore, but we're actually going to use a mutex. In terms of the handles you get from FreeRTOS, they are one and the same, but the underlying object is slightly different and implemented in a different way. A semaphore is effectively, well, it's what its name says on the tin, comes from the sort of railway definition of a semaphore. You can either pass or you cannot, and that's it. So yeah, and a mutex is slightly different, but for what we're doing here, it's actually very, very similar. You can have a look on FreeRTOS website and go through the definitions if you wish, or ask you questions below. And I will happily answer them. So we'll change our definition here. So first call mutex, and we're going to set this to null pointer. Oops. So this is going to be a null pointer when it's initialized statically. And as you can see here, when I hover over this, we get a queue handle, and that handle is ultimately under the hood, the cursed void star pointer. So yeah, don't like void stars at all, so there's but anyway, it's doing that under the hood. And actually, let's stick with our tradition of doing brace initialization here. Okay, very good. So at the moment we've got this mutex, or we actually have a pointer to the mutex, so this is technically a pointer, or a handle as FreeRTOS calls it. We've set it to null pointer, but at the moment it doesn't actually exist. So we need to make it exist. So first of all, we need to do, if this doesn't exist, so we can simply do if not first call mutex, which is equivalent to, effectively the equivalent to doing that. But if not, so that's the way I prefer it. Arguable, very, very arguable, but anyway, I'm going to do it that way. And then we are going to do, just going to copy and paste this in. So we are going to reassign to our handle here, and we are going to create, and in this case we are going to create a mutex. If we wanted a semaphore, it's just xsemaphore create, I think, off the top of my head, but we want a mutex object under here. Now we need to ensure that this exists at this point, because we're going to use it. We'll use the FreeRTOS config assert, and then we will copy and paste that in. All the FreeRTOS config assert does is, if this fails, so if whatever's in the brackets equals false, and you can see Espressif have kindly actually put in an implementation for this macro, and even labeled it unlikely, which is quite handy for the optimizer. But we will get a printf of an assert failed on a particular line in a particular file with a particular function. So you get a nice backtrace, and aborts will be called. So unfortunately it'll be abort and not ESP restart, but your backtrace will tell you that it'll be line 32, blah, 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 in this file. Although, because we're doing this in the header, that may not strictly be true. So realistically, you'd actually want this in your CPP. In fact, you know what? Let's do what I just said. So what we're going to do is we're going to declare the constructor here, and then we are going to implement it here. So let's just sort that indentation out, and there we go. So this is now in the CPP file rather than in the header, and that has some advantages here. So if this will pass if this is not equal to null pointer. So if this is not equal to null pointer, then this will be true. So the assert is fine. Whereas, to be honest, this bit is superfluous. So we're just asserting that this is not null, or null pointer in C++ terminology. If it is null at this point, then clearly something's gone awry, and this assert will fail, we'll get a debug, and we'll get an abort. And I'm very sorry, the washing machine's going in the background, I hope that's not too bad. You know what, I'll just pause it. Give me one sec. Beauty of a washing machine, you can pause. There we go. Sorry, that wasn't very professional, but yeah. Okay, so we create this mutex, and then we actually need to do something with it. Now, interestingly, FreeRTOS semaphores and mutexes are created in the taken state. Hang on, let me just make sure I've got that terminology bang on correct. DBDBDBD, xsemaphore create and create mutex. Let me just pull that up. Sorry, I'd rather pause and just make sure I'm absolutely correct before saying it and misleading you. In the taken state. Okay, so we need to, once we've constructed this semaphore, we then need to give it. Otherwise, it will never be given, never be able to be taken, because it's someone already has it. So what we're going to do is actually before using it, we need to do an assert. So we're going to have a duplication of code here, but I'll explain why that's there in a mo. And then we need to do x semaphore give. And this mutex. And then we should really assert this as well. And actually what we're asserting is that this equals PD pass. And that's from the FreeRTOS documentation. So let's talk about this. If the mutex is a null pointer, then create the mutex, assert that it was created. So if it wasn't, we're going to abort, something's gone wrong. Then we're going to give the mutex, so it is ready to be taken by whoever wants it, and ensure that it was given successfully, which is defined as this function returning PD pass, which is the same as one or true, but we'll use the FreeRTOS terminology here. So why have we got this there? Well, if we come in later on and call this constructor, a new child spawns in, for example, or something, this is already created. Then we're going to do an assert on it to ensure that it was. Actually, that is now superfluous, thinking about it, because at this point, if this is not a null pointer, then that assert, by definition, will not fail. So yes, actually, that is superfluous. So we don't need that. Chatting out my bum. So what do we need to do now? We need to check whether or not this is our first call. But we need to make sure no one else is in this routine. So what we need to do is stick an and on here. Could do this nested, and we want this one, but we don't want to give it, we want to take it. And did I define a second? Yes, I did. And then there's a second parameter here, which is how long, oh, you got it in the tooltip, how long you want to sit there waiting for it. And let's just say a second. Now, you'll see here that PD second doesn't exist in FreeRTOS. It doesn't exist. So that's why I've defined it here. This is not very C++, but neither is FreeRTOS because it's C. So it's defined as 1,000 milliseconds, whatever that is in ticks. And if we hover over this, actually, pretty much all timings in FreeRTOS are in terms of ticks rather than second. So PD second is 1,000 milliseconds, but in ticks. So converted to whatever that is. So if, you know what? I've just realized something. I've got inverted logic here. Right, that should be true because it is going to be our first call, right? And that should be false. I'll tell you what, 10 out of 10 if anyone spotted that. I'm recording this more or less straight after the previous episode, so I won't have had time to read the comments. But yeah, I'm just inverting that logic because this reads better. So if this is the first call, i.e. this is true, so it's equivalent to doing true equals equals like that, which is, should probably add, the same as doing that. The difference is if you by mistake only put one equals, this is now not what you expected it to be, and this is now an assignment, so it will set first call to true. That's not what you want. So if you're doing comparing to a constant, I always recommend putting the constant first. Does exactly the same thing, but if you accidentally do a typo, you'll get a compiler error, because you are trying to assign to a constant and you're not allowed to do that. So it will give you an error and say, you know, you're an idiot, you've missed a second equals off here. Whereas if you do it the other way around, you'll get a warning, or you should get a warning, but, you know, in lots of projects, and I'm in the real world here, you have loads of warnings and they get ignored. So, yeah, anyway, I digress. So if this is our first call and we successfully obtained the semaphore, sorry, the mutex, then we can do our thing. But now at the end of this, we need to give this mutex back, and we already know how to do that. And we will give it back here. So a little bit more verbose, a little bit more to be done here. And one thing that's worth noting is that this semaphore, when we create it, because this is a pointer, effectively, it's a void star, this is being created on the heap. And we can talk at length about pros and cons of heap versus stack memory, and versus static memory. And particularly in embedded stuff, it is generally a good idea to do as much as you can on the stack or in static memory and avoid using the heap apart from when you absolutely have to. So this is using the heap. It's not going to cause any problems. Yes, it will be a bit slower, but it's only happening once. So really, is it going to be a problem? Is it going to cause us a problem? Is this structure massive? No, this is absolutely fine to do. But again, I want to give you all the tools so you can make an informed decision, because if you look at this and say, oh, well, I want to create a different object that's not semaphore, it's quite large, you know, it's whatever it is, and then you come into issues with the heap overflowing or running out of spare blocks in your heap, and be thinking, well, there's got to be a better way. Okay, there is. I'll tell you that better way now. And in FreeRTOS, we can actually allocate the memory that is used for this semaphore statically. So we can allocate this memory at compile time. So we would then know if we're going to run out of memory at compile time rather than runtime, or at least know whether or not this is causing the issue. As I say, realistically, the heap is quite large, hundreds of kilobytes. This object or struct in this case is not hundreds of kilobytes, so you're not really going to see it. But as I say, let's do it the proper way and give you the tools. So to be able to do so, this works. Okay, this is a solution very similar to the standard template library way of doing it, but this is the FreeRTOS way of doing it, which of course is compatible with C. So that's food for thought if you're writing this in C, although I would advise watching a C guide rather than a C++ one, because the methodology is going to be different. So if we're going to allocate the memory that this actually uses at compile time, then we need to actually define the memory. So we'll call it the buffer, and it's going to have a slightly different type. So it's going to be the static semaphore type. There we go. And do we get flavor text if we hover over that? Yeah, we do. It's a static queue type. Now, of course, this is static, so we also not only need to declare it, but we need to define it. I'm probably getting those. I always get define and declare the wrong way around, so I do apologize. I think I was right that time, but anyway, you know what I mean. Embrace initialization. So this is basically the same as saying initialize all the bits to null or zero. Basically, it calls the constructor with the default constructor. All right, let me just pour some more tea, lovely. So we now have a handle to the mutex. So this hasn't changed, which is really, really useful. But we also now have the memory. So this structure, the actual structure that is going to hold all the inner workings of this mutex and its state and whether it's taken or given and blah, blah, blah. That memory is now here, statically allocated at compile time rather than at runtime being allocated on the heap. Now, we need a slightly different call here. So we're going to create mutex static and we are going to give it a pointer to this buffer, to this memory. So we want the address of this buffer. So the ampersand there is saying the address of this buffer, which is statically. And then everything else is exactly the same. We don't need to change anything else. So the only difference is now we know that this memory exists at compile time and there is no heap allocation at all. And that's really, really useful, particularly if you have lots of these. And yeah, probably for this sort of thing, these allocations are small. They're going to happen more or less at initialization time. So when your program first starts, so they'll be reasonably addressed and not in the middle of your heap memory, causing it to be two smaller chunks rather than one big long chunk. Yeah, plenty of advantages. But if you can, particularly for embedded stuff, it's always worth doing as much as you can at compile time when you are, for a start, on your desktop PC that's got a lot more computing power, but the optimizer can do its thing and make your code slicker. So you're offloading not only runtime cycles, but you're also optimizing better, hopefully, maybe. But also it will flag if you run out of memory, or you're more likely to get told at compile time, nah, you're out of memory, rather than it just crashing randomly in your code because your heaps run out. So how are we doing on time? 27. Yeah, okay, right, let's do the other one. So that's to do it statically. Everything else stays the same. Semaphore give, semaphore state, all stays the same because this handle is the same. And that's really, really good and well written from the FreeRTOS point of view. Makes it very, very easy. So we mentioned about a recursive mutex. So at the moment, this mutex is private. So it means that only this object has access to this. But what if we wanted to make this available to be used by any child classes? So anyone that inherits this, we might want to give them access to this mutex. This is a bit of a contrived example. I don't recommend doing this, but I shall include it because it's something we will probably be using later down the line. So I can just say, refer back to this video when we talked about mutexes. Makes more sense for it to be here. So if the child wants access to it, then it can't be private unless we do friendship stuff. And I must say, I'm not a fan of friendship. So we'll make it protected. So you can't access it outside of this class, but anyone who inherits this class will have access to it. Assuming they set their inheritance, blah, blah, blah. We'll cover that later. But anyway, that's largely what we're trying to do here. So all we've done is just change the scope. This is now protected. So the code, this all code still works. I'm pointing at my monitor there, but I haven't got face cam on. So this is all still absolute fine. I'll tell you what, we've not compiled it in a while, so let's just make sure that I'm not chatting rubbish and this works. So as before, you know, just a bit more wordy, create the thing that's given us mutual exclusion, and then we take it and ensure that only one person executes this at once, because this can only be taken once. Yes, there we go, that generated, so yippee. We will obviously later down the line start flashing this to an ESP, like we did in the Blink example, episode one, because just saying it compiles doesn't mean it works, and a lot of the time, yeah, it won't work because you'll get runtime issues. But for now, while we're on simple stuff, we'll just do this. And maybe if you're playing along at home, then your task can be to flash this and see if it actually runs, or whether I'm an idiot who shouldn't be on YouTube here. Now, as we mentioned before, if there's some sort of child class, say, so child of Wi-Fi, oops, and the constructor of this is pseudocode here, is going to effectively do something where it's going to take this semaphore. So it's going to do some stuff, take this semaphore, as I say, this is a very contrived example, and then call the base class constructor, and then it's going to give the semaphore. So this is just pseudocode here, obviously this won't work, and then maybe it does something else before returning the object. Hopefully you can see what the problem is here. Yeah, this is hugely contrived, but anyway, we take this semaphore to ensure we're the only one running this bit of code at once, and then we call the Wi-Fi constructor. So we do this bit. Let's ignore the initialization bit. Let's just say this is good, all right, and this isn't out of order, all right. So yeah, ignore that for the moment. I'm just trying to make a point. And then we get to here. Say it's the first call, so this is true. So yes, the first call, we're going to try and take this mutex. We're going to wait for a second, and then we're going to exit, because, well, we've got two problems here. The mutex has already been taken. You can't take it twice. But we're the same person, we're the same object, we're the same thread on the same CPU. So it shouldn't really matter, because we should be able to take it more than once if it is just us taking it. If it was another thread coming in, yeah, we want to block that. But if it's still us taking the same one, then clearly that's okay, because we're handling that and we've written that code. We'll come back to the bug here, which, of course, I would love to say it was a deliberate mistake, to see if you're paying attention, but actually it's not, because I'm not following my notes and I'm an idiot. But we'll come back to that at the end. So I will tell you now, there is a bug somewhere in these lines of code highlighted there. Quite a significant, huge bug. Okay, so if you want, pause the screen here, but anyway, we'll talk about this recursive mutex first, so you've got time for your gray matter to do its thing. So can we take a mutex more than once? No, but we can take a recursive mutex more than once, as long as it is the same thread taking it. What's the difference? Well, actually very little, because FreeRTOS is really good at providing an interface that is the same. So the only thing that needs to change, if I expand this back out, is rather than creating a mutex that is static, we're going to create a recursive mutex that is static. That's the only line of code that changes. Now, if this is pdpass, so if this passes, we then go into the constructor, ignore that, then we try and take it again. Under the hood, this function is going to say, well, hang on, it's already taken. Ah, but the person who took it was us. So I will let you take this again. If it's not us, then it won't. It will sit here and wait and do what we expect it to do. But if it's us, it will do the thing. Then we'll do our stuff and we'll give it back. Have a think. What state is the mutex now in at this point here? It is still taken. It has been taken once up here. So we take it once, we take it twice. We undo one of the takes, so it is now just taken once, which is why we need to give it again here. So it's like a counting semaphore, very similar. So rather than being on or off, it will count the number of times it's taken, and you have to give it back the same number of times before another thread can take it again. Okay. It's perfectly okay for us to take it again, that's not a problem, but for another thread to take it, it has to have been given fully, i.e. it has not been taken at all. So all the takes have their corresponding gives. And this is where it gets a little bit more wordy and you have to make sure that your flow is okay, and where the standard library implementations with RAII is a little bit cleaner, but that's not a recursive, although it does have, there is a different one you can use that is. What if you don't want to do this as static? Well, very similarly to what we did before, we get rid of the static, so we are going to just create a recursive mutex, not a static recursive mutex, and then for we don't give it this buffer, and actually we can get rid of that line altogether, and this will now create it on the heap. So, and again, all the other code stays the same. So really, really nice implementation there by FreeRTOS. I'll leave this in, as you can see here. So it is not only the recursive mutex, but it is also the static recursive mutex. And you can use the video as reference to, you know, whether or not you need recursive. I wouldn't recommend with using recursive. You might just think, well, why don't I make everything recursive and static? Well, because it depends what you're trying to do. It might be that actually you don't want the thread to be able to take it more than once, even if it's the same thread, because you want to block and allow another thread to do something. So you might not want a recursive, or there's a million one different reasons why you might not want this to be recursive all the time. And static, you might just not care. You're using it once, you want to get rid of these extra lines of code. So, or you might not have the configure static allocation turned on in FreeRTOS. I forget whether it's on by default. Let's have a look at the menu config. Because yes, you might try this and it not work. Well, it should work because you'll have my SDK config here. So let's just wait for menu config to do its thing. And let's scroll down and find FreeRTOS. Not pthreads. FreeRTOS, here we go. So FreeRTOS, abort on fail assertions. Oh, right, yeah, that's quite cool. Don't recommend changing any of these unless you need to. Check that mutex 74 is given by owner task. Oh, right, that's cool. I didn't know it did that. Where's static allocation? I'm used to configuring this on an STM32. In which case you have a header file. Oh, okay, it isn't. So one would assume it's on by default in that case. So we'll get rid of this sudo code because we don't want that. And let's just make sure this compiles and I'm not chatting a load of nonsense. And then the last thing we'll cover is what this bug is. Have you found it yet? If not, have a pause now. Scratch your head. What is the issue here? Oh, and it's going to build it from scratch because I've opened menu config. Okay, so let's start talking about this then. And this is where drawing things and writing things down will be very helpful to you as a programmer. Can be a lot easier than reading code, but it also gives you a different way of looking at what you've written or what you're going to write, so you can foresee bugs. As you get better, that will become less required, but still, myself as an experienced programmer, I still write stuff down because I've learned the hard way, you know. And after making silly mistakes a number of times, you go, you know what, I'm just going to practice what I preach. But this one I've spotted, thankfully. So what's the logic? We're in the constructor, so someone is trying to build a Wi-Fi object. If this is the first call, so if this is true, and we obtain the semaphore, then we're going to get our MAC address, set our flag, give the semaphore back, so on and so forth. Okay, that sounds good. If it is not our first call, so this is false, this is irrelevant because this is false. So the AND won't even be looked at because it's already false before we've even got to here. So we'll just fall through. Not a problem because it's not our first call, so we've already got the MAC address. Everyone's happy. Semaphore, who cares? Doesn't matter. We've already called this thing because first call is now false. But the other case, if this is our first call, true, we try and take the semaphore, we wait a second, in this case, this can be whatever number you want in ticks, but we wait a second, and we still do not obtain the semaphore. So this returns PD fail, or false, but we'll stick with the FreeRTOS naming conventions here for when we're using FreeRTOS stuff. This whole statement is now false, because if true, this failed, so is false. So if true and false evaluates to false. This now exits and we end up down here. So we are now in the state where the Wi-Fi object, or its child, whatever it is, has been constructed. First call is still true because we never got to this code. So our MAC address was never populated. So best case scenario is just going to be a bunch of zeros, which it is because that's how we initialized it. So at least it's not going to run away. But we have now constructed the object, but we haven't got the MAC address, and we didn't set our flag. If we only constructed this object once, that means we will never get our MAC address, because we're never going to call that code. So anyone who tries to get the MAC address to use it for whatever it's using it for is just going to get a bunch of zeros back. It's actually just going to get a null pointer back in our implementation. And this is where this bug can be a little bit sneaky. If we were constructing more than one object, or say more than one child object, which is more likely to be the case, then this is going to come through a second time. It'll see that first call is still true, despite there already being an object existing. So you can see where the bug is already, that it's not doing what it's supposed to have done, and it's going to obtain this semaphore. If we're lucky, this will pass second time round. Maybe it was blocked first time round. There's logic as to why that would have failed. Realistically, it shouldn't have done, but let's say it did. We'll get the MAC address on the second time of asking. First call would be set to false, and then everything is fine. But if it failed first time, it may well fail second time, so it never gets called and never gets called. But what you see in here is you may get different results, different times you execute this code, which is a bit of a mind melter. So that's where the bug is. The bug is we could exit this constructor having not constructed, i.e. in our definition, not called this getMac, which we're saying we need to do on the first call. And there is a chance we exit this first call without having called this function. So, or this method. How can we do this better? Largely it depends. Realistically, what is this semaphore doing? It is blocking us from accessing this first call variable if someone else is currently in this routine. So this is fundamentally flawed because we're checking this variable before we obtain the semaphore. So really, it's not quite doing what we wanted in the first place anyway. So it would make more sense to take the semaphore first. So follow this through. So first of all, take the semaphore. Basically, make sure no one else is doing this stuff at the moment, which is going to cause this variable to change. And then once we've got the semaphore, if this is our first call, so if this is true, then we'll do the things, set it to false. And you've hopefully noticed that this needs to now drop down to here. If it's not our first call, then we're immediately going to give the semaphore back and carry on. We've already done this stuff because it's not our first call. Everything is good. So at the moment, this does exactly what it did before. Still, it's one bug fewer because now we've protected this variable with the semaphore. So no one can read this variable whilst we're trying to set it. But we still have the bug. What if this take fails? Well, now we've got the construct to stick an else in here. And we could do, we could do anything we want. We could do an ESP reset here. Sorry, restart. Because something's gone wrong. We failed to take this. Something has gone horribly, horribly wrong. Because we're in a constructor, we're not returning anything. So we can't just, you know, return ESP error no mem, for example, might be a good one. Or just ESP fail, because we're in a constructor. So we don't have that available to us. So at this point, if we fail to construct the object, we could set a flag in our object to say, yeah, it was built correctly and the constructor was good. That has its pros and cons. We could do a config assert, which is a free RTOS assert. since we're using FreeRTOS things here. I can't remember if you can put a message in there. No, you cannot. So this looks a bit rubbish, but it's unlikely. To be honest, I would be more happy putting an ESP restart there. Or would I? No, config assert's quite good because you get a backtrace. But there's multiple things you can do here. Something's gone wrong. We could try again. So that would be perfectly valid. So what we could do here, if we were being really clever, is put a continue. And then do for, and let's do int I equals 0. I is less than, say, we'll try 3 times, plus plus I. And here we'll break. So what's this saying now? This is saying we're going to do this loop 3 times. Maximum of 3 times. First of all, we're going to try and take the semaphore. If we obtain the semaphore, then we either run this routine if it's our first call. If not, we just skip this, give the semaphore back, and then break out of the for loop. So we'll end up down here. If we fail to obtain the semaphore, we're going to continue, which means go to the back to the start of the loop, which means I will get incremented. This will now be attempt number 1. Oops, 1 out of 3. So we'll try up to 3 times to break out. But the problem here is we could end up exiting this for loop when we're on our 4th try. So I is equal to 3, in this case 0, 1, 2, 3. And 3 being the 4th because we started counting at 0. So we're going to break out of this loop having never done this. So we might just want to protect this by having bool it worked is equal to true. Oh, sorry, it is false. For example, and I should brace initialize that really. And then here we'll set it to true. And then we can say at the end of this, if it didn't work, so if not it worked, ESP restart. Like that. So this now has just been extended a little bit more. Okay, we've added more lines of code. I'm not necessarily saying this is the way you want to do this. But we're saying we'll give it three attempts, up to 3 attempts. If it passes on the first one, great. Second one, great. Third one, great. But if it's still not passed, then we're going to restart the CPU. And at that point, something's gone very wrong. And we could put in, you know, debug messages in here. So we could put logger warning and say our tag is Wi-Fi. And hopefully you're familiar with the logging. Failed to get mutex. And let's put the value of I in there so we know which attempt this is. And you could even say attempt, and in this case, because we're counting from 0, attempt plus just add 1. So if this is the first attempt, it's actually the 0th attempt, which looks a bit odd when you're debugging, so we'll just add 1 to it. So this will go from 1 to 3 rather than 0 to 2. So you could do something like that. So that's the FreeRTOS way of doing things. I'm going to take this log statement out just because we haven't included the correct header to do that. Up to you whether or not you think this is the better way of doing it. This way is C compatible. Obviously, it you know, might not be in a constructor, but this the FreeRTOS way is C compatible. There are mutexes and stuff that you can use in C as well. So there's lots of different ways of doing stuff. Interested to hear what you think, whether you think there would be you've got an a use case for this. I wouldn't say just use it because it's using memory resources, it's using clock cycles. Use it if you need it. This is, as I say, a contrived example, because realistically calling this function multiple times isn't going to use as much CPU time, or perhaps might not use as much CPU time as all this branching, all this looping, the taking of semaphores, and the cost that inherently gives us. But you know, this could be a different example where we're doing lots of other different bits and bobs, and that will be the case later down the line. So we'll be able to refer back to this, remember what we did. So I'm going to save this file. I'm going to push this up to GitHub now. Video 5. And push to YouTube. Ironically, is going to the YouTube branch on GitHub. So that is now there before I've even uploaded the video. Thoughts, questions, and so on below in the comments. And yeah, next episode we'll actually start doing some Wi-Fi stuff and actually getting this Wi-Fi class up and running, doing the things we want it to do. So I'll lock down between episodes what this is actually going to be and the implementation I want it to be for this project. I'm probably not going to use the FreeRTOS one just because it's very, very wordy and I want to keep things simple. And also I want to try something that I've not used very much, which is actually the standard template library mutex. I think that would be quite nice, and I don't use that as often, and it's a lot cleaner, I think. So I'll do that between episodes. Of course, that will be updated in next episode's code, so you've got it there. And yeah, we'll start doing some Wi-Fi stuff, and hopefully very, very soon we will be able to send Hello World and receive Hello World over Wi-Fi. That'd be cool. Till then, ta-ta for now.